This podcast is a member of the Place to Be Nation family. Visit us at placetobenation.com, the only place to be in your pop culture world.
Welcome to the Row One Seat One podcast. We got some great guests on this week. We got JB is going to be on this week talking about his tours with pretty much every 90s band you've heard of. And we're also going to have Josh Allen and Jesse on this week talking about the marriage of hardcore music and wrestling. This is going to be our music episode, but I couldn't have this week happen without the talk of the Bruins and the Stanley Cup. And to that effect, I'm having on Peter Winson for a few minutes on to talk about his beloved Bruins. Peter's a Bruins Stanley Cup holder. He is a host of the Greetings from Allentown podcast. We're going to have him on for a few minutes to talk hopefully a lot of shit about the Bruins. Rumors as good as fact. And we're just going to have him on for a few minutes to just talk about the Bruins before we have our music episode on this week. I am Ben, otherwise known as Boston Nuga. Like I said, this is the Row One Seat One podcast. Thank you guys for sticking around. Thank you guys for coming on. And indulge me for a few minutes and indulge my Bostonian nature for a few minutes and Peter's Bostonian nature for a few minutes because we're going to talk about the Bruins. Peter, the Bruins are in the Stanley Cup, brother.
I'm so excited. And for all the people out there that are just kind of rolling their eyes over the Boston thing, we're so sick of Boston. Let me just point out that the Bruins fan base is a little bit different than the other fan bases in Boston. The Red Sox and Patriots might carry a little bit more arrogance. And yes, they have won a lot. Maybe they've earned the right to be arrogant. The Bruins fan base is a little bit different. We've had our hardships.
Way more blue collar.
Beat down. What's that?
Way more blue collar. The Bruins fan base is way more blue collar, way more salt of the earth, way more dyed in the wool than the other Boston fan bases. They've been through some shit.
Absolutely. And I've been party to a lot of it. You know, not only losing division titles on the last day of the season, losing playoff spots, blowing 3-0 leads in the playoffs. I mean, you know, I got to enjoy that as a Red Sox fan in 2004. From when the Yankees did it, and then having my own team do it 6 years later was difficult. But then the next year, they galvanized, they turned it around and won the Stanley Cup in 2011. By far my top moment as a sports fan ever.
So let's talk about this year's Bruins. Who are some of the better players? Why are the Bruins in the Cup? What are the main reasons why this year's Boston Bruins are in the Stanley Cup?
Well, some wise ass out there is probably shouting at their pod catcher or whatever and saying, "Oh, they're there because Tampa lost." To which I would say, "Well, first of all, we beat the team that beat Tampa, and then we also beat the team that beat Washington, and we beat the team that swept Pittsburgh." Not to go down that rabbit hole and have the inception horn go off or anything like that, but this is a very well put together, well constructed team with a very interesting mix of talents. You don't have a lot of guys necessarily in their prime of their career, i.e. between the age of 25 and 29. There's a split between guys who are in their 30s. Patrice Bergeron, Brad Marchand is now 30 years old, believe it or not. I mean, the time passes so quick. You have David Krejci, who turned 33 recently and has the same birthday as me. And, of course, Zdeno Chara, who I think is 59, 60 years
old. 11 billion years old.
42 years old and still going strong. But on the other end, as part of this rebuild, retool that they've had over the last few years, they drafted Charlie McAvoy in the middle of the first round, which is an absolute steal, because if you redid that draft, he goes in the top three without question in 2016. And while they may have dropped, and there's always questions, they dropped the ball in the 2015 draft. They got Jake DeBrusk out of it. That's a second line right wing. Those guys don't grow on trees. And in addition to all the young guys, Danton Heinen, who's a very good possession forward who does the little things, the trade deadline acquisitions that they made, I feel have been extremely beneficial, just like in 2011 with Chris Kelly and Rich Peverly. You got Charlie Coyle filling that third line center role to a T. And during the regular season, he wasn't scoring much. He wasn't putting up a lot of points, but I was noticing he would do little things. He would win faceoffs. He would, you know, work the cycle game down low and basically just maintain possession. The scoring from him has emerged in these playoffs. Marcus Johansson, who was picked up from the New Jersey Devils, he didn't pick it up until game 7 of the first round. It was just in time. He scored what ended up being the game-winning goal in the series against Toronto, and he has picked up his game and has given them the secondary scoring that any team that wants to win the Stanley Cup needs. And I have to say, I said my buy-in on this team was absolute and total dating back to, I want to say, December, so the first couple of months of the season, because I went to the Winter Classic in Indiana on January 1st, so I kind of felt, you know, invested because of that. But with the way this group has just kind of grown together during the season, they're fun to watch.
This isn't a superstar-led team either. This isn't, you know, a one superstar, one big goal scorer-led team. This is, you know, a cohesive unit too.
It's very unusual for a team to not have a super high draft pick. Usually in the final, you'll have like an Alex Ovechkin last year, Sidney Crosby, guys who were picked in the top three of the NHL draft. The Bruins don't have any of those guys because they traded Tyler Seguin to Dallas, which I defend on the grounds of, at the time, he definitely had attitude issues. There were certainly whispers. And if you were going to trade, if you're going to trade either him or Brad Marchand, you made the correct choice, because Marchand, for all of his foibles, has been a better player than Tyler Seguin in the last 5 years.
This is factual.
Yes, absolutely. And I'm not going to be one of those guys who just defends everything that Brad Marchand does, but let's not pretend that he's the only guy who ever punched somebody in the head in a scrum in hockey. I mean, this is the NHL where
he's a pest. He's a pest. Yeah. He's the definition of a pest, and yeah, I love him for that.
Yeah, they're men. He knows how to defend himself. Is he going to, you know, drop the gloves and knock somebody out? No, but that's not what he does. And in fact, the way he's kind of grown and not done that stuff as much over the last season and a half, thank God, because I've been waiting for that moment to happen. He got 100 points this year, first Bruin with 100 points in a season since Joe Thornton in 2003. And I just love everything that I've seen from this team. And I haven't even mentioned the great Tuukka Rask in net.
The great Tuukka Rask
has been an absolute wall over this 7-game winning streak from game 4 in the Columbus series all the way through the sweep in the conference final against Carolina.
So if you're someone who doesn't watch hockey and only picks it up in the Stanley Cup finals, why should you pick Boston over one of the Western Conference teams? What are the rooting reasons for Boston?
Because the Boston Bruins have Patrice Bergeron, the greatest class act in the NHL today, who is the perfect
hockey player. Preach.
Who does everything you could want from a hockey player well. He wins faceoffs. He back checks. He's a team guy. He's a leader. He scores clutch goals like it's a bodily function. I mean, all through, dating back to when he was 18 years old in 2004, scoring an overtime goal against Montreal in the playoffs. This is a kid who was playing midget hockey at age 16, only played 1 year of junior hockey, and then is in the NHL the following year, 41 points as a rookie. I think he only finished 5th in the Calder, but I don't know who he was going up against. But Patrice Bergeron is the perfect hockey player, and from all accounts that I've ever heard, I've never had the pleasure of actually meeting him, a perfect human being as well.
So people should root for this team because we've got the hot goalie. We've got Patrice Bergeron. We play cohesively as a team. We've got the tough guys. We've got the pest. We're really that rootable, you know, despite Boston winning everything, we're the blue-collar fans. We're the not the typical Boston fans. Is that what you're trying to tell me?
Yeah, and I would also be remiss if I did not mention David Backes, who has been a fine player in the NHL for, I think, 12 years now. I'm actually staring at an old Bruins program that I have of him on the cover on my wall. Played all that time in St. Louis, unable to get to the Stanley Cup final, and now he's there and may ironically end up playing his former team to win his first Stanley Cup. And also a great role model as well. When he struggled, he got scratched, he was taken out of the lineup, but he never lost his smile. He got right back in there, and he delivered, he produced in whatever role that was given to him, scored a big goal against Columbus. So I've always loved and respected David Backes, and I hope that they win this one for him, among you know all the other reasons, too.
Is it St. Louis who you want to see?
I don't really care all that much, but since I'm more willing to talk about it than my other Bruin fan friends, I would much rather play San Jose because I think that team is just burnt to shit. So by the time they get to the final, they're going to – I think they're just going to be exhausted. And also, San Jose has a lot of particularly stupid players like Michael Haley and Evander Kane who are just going to run around and take penalties and finally – the Bruins have a team with a power play that can make teams pay for doing stuff like that, as opposed to 2011 when I think they went 0 for 135 in the playoffs on the power play.
Is Thornton still on San Jose?
Oh, he is, yes. He's got the gray beard, the long Civil War general thing going.
That would be fascinating.
I was always a huge fan of Joe Thornton when he was traded. That broke my heart because Joe was the first athlete in Boston who was actually younger than me, so I considered him as like from my generation. So to see him going for his first Stanley Cup against the Bruins would be a fascinating storyline for me, although I don't want to see him get it.
Yeah, I actually worked for the Bruins at the time when they traded Thornton, and let me tell you, that was one of the worst days of my professional life.
Yes.
Just terrible. Just absolutely terrible. A lot of angry callers that day asking for their money back. But that's another story for another time. But I think that would be a fascinating storyline, Joe Thornton going against the Bruins. But whoever the Bruins play, the Bruins are in the Stanley Cup. You will be there for all of the games, I suspect, correct?
I will be. The charge for game 1 and 2 hit my credit card on schedule. The Bruins are never late on that. I can assure you of that.
What's the upcharge on that?
I believe my seat is about $186 per game, which
That's a lot more. That's a lot less than I thought it would be, actually.
Yeah, well, in 2011, it was $73.
Oh, Lord.
So what they figured out in hockey, and I don't know if the NBA is the same or Major League Baseball, they figured out that we can charge whatever we want for the playoffs for season ticket holders, and people are going to pay it because it's the number one perk if you're watching a team that's a contender is the access to playoff tickets. And I'm so excited that I finally get to see a game one of the Cup Finals. I'm really stoked for this next week on Memorial Day. It's going to be great.
And just this is a long held belief of mine that playoff hockey, greater than sign, any other playoff sport, as far as drama and, sheer enjoyment level of watching. Give our listenership the same pitch because you actually get to see it live, and you're a fan of every sport as well.
Yeah, I don't know if I've never been to a basketball playoff game. I've been to a couple of NFL playoff games, and those are just kind of long and drawn out because of all the TV timeouts. And I've been to baseball playoffs, also a little long and drawn out, especially with it being like the 2008. Red Sox playing long games. Playoff hockey just literally takes your breath away. And I'm not talking about Like the there was one year in the playoffs as a superstition where I was wearing the towel like a member of the Shield, like around my face, and it was cutting off the air to my brain, and it was really starting to hurt. But just watching it, and you're so tense. Like, I've been to four game sevens that went into overtime.
Oh Lord!
And you're watching that, and you know that one team is going to move on, and the other team's going to die. And it's been 2-2. In my experience for the Bruins, and you just never forget that feeling of when they give up the goal or when they score the goal in overtime in game seven. It's I can almost remember something from every single playoff game that I've gone to, because you know it's the excitement it is second to none of any event that I've ever been to, save for, you know, maybe WrestleMania 35 was good. And I don't say that to rub that in your face, Ben.
No, it's okay.
I'm sorry.
Okay. My therapist and I are working on it. We're working on it hard. It's okay. Peter, you're a gem. You're an absolute gem. Go Bruins. We're going to have a blast this next few weeks. And whoever they play, we're going to hopefully it's been a long, I think it's 106 days now since Boston's won a championship, and we need to break the drought, brother.
Yeah, and this, I really hope that I have a parade to go to in June, because I have not been to any of the celebrations since the 2011 parade. So,
really? Interesting.
Yeah. I've never been to a Patriots parade, because it's always in February, and it's always like a blizzard the day before. So it's one of those weird coincidences, but...
I've been to a couple Red Sox, and I've been to a Celtics. I've never been to a Bruins, but I'm far away now. So please pour one out for me. Peter, you're a gem. God bless, my friend. Good luck.
Yep.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks for having me on.
All right, it is music week, and I am here with JB, and JB is a dear, dear friend. JB has seen and done everything in the music industry. Tell us a little bit about yourself, JB.
All right, thanks, Ben, for having me. First of all, as far as the music industry goes, because we're connected to the world of wrestling. We became friends through that medium, but music has always been a huge part of my life. I got involved working in radio and television at a very young age, 16 years old. I had a radio show by the time I was 16, and kind of parlayed that radio career to meeting in a lot of cool bands, especially in the mid to late 90s. And during that time period, I got to go on lots of ventures, which we've been kind of talking about on the side here before we get started.
Now, basically, you gave me the list, and you were, you know, in the 90s is when you kind of had your heyday. Give me the who's who list of the bands that you toured with and have seen and are close with and are familiar with. You basically said everyone but Nirvana, basically, right?
Yeah, pretty much everybody out of the quote-unquote alternative rock scene, grunge scene, I was in. I had some contact with. I became very close with a band from central Pennsylvania, a little town called York, PA, called Live. And Live was... You know, they had a couple of big albums there in the 90s.
That song, Lightning Crashes, was huge.
Lightning Crashes, a huge, huge song. Throwing Copper, mm-hmm. which sold, I think, about at this point now, it's about 12 or 13 million copies of that album. But it became very close to those guys in 1991. I have a really cool story on how I got to know those guys and how I kind of got my in, and I guess I could share that.
Go ahead.
Number one, the relationship I have with the guys in live has been a up and down relationship. We're more on the downside these days, and there's a few things that I told you I couldn't talk about when we got started. Let's just put it this way. At one point, there was some bad stuff that went on, and I was under a gag order from New York Superior Court. So we'll leave it at that. Nothing bad on my part, but let's just say that I learned some things that I probably shouldn't have learned.
You've seen some shit.
seen some shit, learned some things, saw a few things that were not the best things. But getting back to the story here, in 1993, I would have been about 13 years old, and my best friend, Nate, rest in peace, Nate. Nate's no longer with us. Nate was like my big brother, took me everywhere, and he actually got me into traveling to wrestling shows, too. Nate was 4 years older than I was, so I was 13. He was 17. He had a car, so that meant we were driving. And we were going wherever we could go.
That's the best type of friend to have when you're 13.
Exactly. And my dad worked out of town all the time, and my mother just basically at that point was kind of like, okay. He's with his big brother. He'll be all right. Because Nate was 6'6", 250 pounds. And, I was a little guy with a big mouth, so I needed that guy around me. But long story short, 1993 rolls around. Live had just come out with their first album called Mental Jewelry. Had sold a couple million off that. And they were playing a local show at a bar called Bogart's in Cincinnati, Ohio. I grew up in northern Kentucky, not far from Cincinnati. And this bar is notorious. It's on the west side. It is near the campus of University of Cincinnati. So if you know anything about Cincinnati, that is the worst part of the city. And I told Nate and a couple of the guys that were there, like, let me get in the car. I don't care if I don't get into the bar, but I want a chance. So I walked in, got in line, just like you would see like at a regular club. There's a bouncer outside checking everybody's IDs. He doesn't check my ID, and I walk in.
And a 13-year-old kid.
13-year-old kid in a bar. And go in and have the time of my life, see them play. They do like 13 songs, 10 originals, a few covers. And go to the merch table and talk to the guys in the band, and I meet up with Chad Taylor, who's the lead guitarist from the band. And he said, I've been spotting you the whole time we've been here. How old are you? And I told him, I said, I was 13. And he said, how in the fuck did you get in here? And I said, nobody checked my ID. He goes, well, that's one of the coolest stories you'll be able to ever tell. But he said, here's the deal. He goes, we're not that much older than you. Because at the time, they were like 19 or 20 when they signed their first deal. So they're fresh out of high school with an album that's already sold a couple million and living a big life. Well, over the years, I became very close to that band and got to know them really well. Fast forward to the summer of 1997, I graduate from high school, and I'm supposed to be registered for summer quarter classes at the university that I was attending. Let's just say that I did not attend. I took all of my scholarship money that I had left over and other assorted money, and I hopped on a bus, and I traveled with Live for three straight months on their Secret Samadhi tour in 1997.
It's the most fucking rock and roll story I've ever heard.
I was 18 years old, had no business being out there, and they just wanted me to hang around because I was cool. So that was the story. And long story short, after pulling all that together, we've been very close over the years. I actually was doing work for them and was working for them, doing some PR work. I actually ran their social media accounts for a while. And through that time period and going on tours with them and various other bands, had a chance to meet a lot of really cool guys and some guys who aren't with us today. I was around Scott Weiland. I was around Chris Cornell. I was around guys who no longer with us, who other demons got the best of them, and depression's a bitch, So yeah. Those are things that, really hold in my heart, those memories. It was a great time, and, there's lots of other cool side stories and things I can add to it. Just tell me where to go, and we'll talk about it.
Well, you mentioned, Weiland and Cornell and the guys in Live and stuff like that. Who is one guy you saw when he wasn't big, or she, when he wasn't big, in front of 20 people and said, holy shit, they're going to be a star?
I'll tell you the artist that I saw early on that really hit me, and it wasn't so much that they got huge, but it was just the voice that got me, and that was hearing Shirley Manson from Garbage the first time.
Yeah.
I saw Garbage early on, and there was probably like 75 people in like a little club. You know, so that was a band that, you know, had some notoriety, but her voice is what captured me. You know, it was like instantaneous. I was like, that's going somewhere.
Yeah, they were so good.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, there's lots of other, you know, like new bands you meet along the way, like people that you meet along the way that like I'm still friends with because of the music too. So much like our wrestling family, our wrestling community, we have that music community is the same way. There's so many people I met just through certain bands or certain scenes that I still talk to today.
Now, it's funny you mentioned wrestling because one thing that really interested me because, you know, I met you through wrestling and you've been a lifelong wrestling fan as well.
Yeah.
Were any of these musicians that you were into, because you've been a wrestling fan this whole time, was wrestling ever a thing that was brought up when you were on the road with any of these bands? Was that ever a thing that was talked about? Were are any musicians that we know, you know, secret closeted wrestling fans?
Secret closet wrestling fans, eh? No, there's lots of guys that we'd have casual conversations about it. One of the bands that, you know, or one of the connections to the scene was, of course, when people started finding out that Rick Rubin was tied to Smoky Mountain Wrestling and was the guy running and bankrolling that, helping Cornette with that. That was a big, big deal for a lot of people because it was like, oh, this guy who's at the very apex of the music industry, he's a wrestling fan, which was cool. You know, and he was producing a lot of bands that actually had the same interest and would talk about that. I know that, for instance, the guys from the Black Crows were huge wrestling fans.
Really?
And, you know, so that was, you know, that was a big, big deal. The guys from Collective Soul, they grew up in Georgia. Ed and Dean Rowland, lead guitarist and the lead singer from that band, who I got to have a few conversations with, they would talk about Georgia Championship Wrestling from when they were kids. You know, Gordon Zoli doing Georgia Championship Wrestling. So, you know, yeah, there was conversations all the time that, you know, about other stuff, because believe it or not, they don't want to talk about music. They want to talk about other stuff too. You know, so that's their business. It's what they do. It's like the guys in the wrestling business I've talked to, they would much rather have a conversation about something else, you know, 90% of the time.
Oh, yeah.
They want to, you know, have a real conversation about whatever else is going on in their life. And they appreciate you being able to engage them that way. So, you know, there is a cross-section for sure, especially with a lot of the bands that were in the South. You know, and some Northeastern bands too. Like, you know, for instance, like with Live, their producer was Jerry Harrison. Jerry Harrison, of course, a Rock and Roll Hall of Fame member with the Talking Heads. And he was out of that CBGB scene, you know, from New York and the Bowery. And another band that came out of there, of course, was Blondie. And Blondie are huge, huge wrestling fans. And they talk a lot about – there's actually a cool clip out there on YouTube right now that I saw where they were on David Letterman. And they were talking about the difference between watching wrestling in the 80s from Atlanta and the New York product.
This is Debbie Harry and Blondie.
Yes, Debbie Harry Blondie, talking about, you know, just how cool and how much they loved it. She was famous for wearing a Dr. X shirt on stage. Now, Dr. X was the other persona of Dick the Destroyer Byer. So, you know, so that was another, you know, she was famous for wearing that shirt on stage, and sometimes not much more than that shirt on stage. So, you know, there's actually a really famous picture of her wearing just nothing but that shirt, and there's a camera view coming up from underneath, you know, let's just say that. You see a little bit of everything. But, you know, that is, you know, those cool cross sections, those cool cross stories that we could tell about those two industries, because I've heard a lot of old school wrestlers say, you know, that being in the wrestling lifestyle was the closest thing to being a rock star.
Yeah.
It was making those trips and being on the
road. You're on the road all the time, you know, yeah.
On the road constantly, especially back in the 70s and the 80s and the 90s, those are really two things that you could, you know, put a correlation together and say that absolutely those two lifestyles are two things that are completely similar.
You mentioned Smoky Mountain. You mentioned Rick Rubin. Now, I know Smoky Mountain was something very near and dear to your heart where you grew up.
Yeah.
Talk about you as a wrestling fan a little bit too. I know this is really a music episode, but Smoky Mountain was something very near and dear to your heart, and you know Rick Rubin was involved in it and stuff like that. Your experiences with Smoky Mountain as well, because that's something not a lot of people talk about.
Yeah, and I've had a chance to run into a few people since I moved to the Carolinas who were heavily involved in that too. I moved to the Charlotte area about 9 years ago, and But I grew up in northeastern Kentucky, right where Ohio, West Virginia, Kentucky come together in a tri-state area. My grandmother lived in the heart of the Appalachians in Pikeville, Kentucky. And God rest her soul, she just passed away back in December. But she, for some reason, put up with multiple teenage boys coming and just staying at her house for free on weekends just to make trips where we'd hit two or three smoky shows every weekend. And she would put up with a house full of teenage boys and feed us breakfast, feed us dinner, you know, take care of us, you know, over a 2 or 3 day period while we would, you know, literally jump behind the boys in their cars and follow them to the next show. We would do the same loop. And I did that, you know, over about a, you know, about a 2 or 3 year period, and at least hit, you know, somewhere probably in the neighborhood of 40 or 50 shows.
What was, now you've been to a lot of, what would Smokey compare to in the music industry? I mean,
Smokey was like
gritty as hell.
It was gritty as can be. It was like going to a dank club, to see a band that was more of a startup or more of it, maybe even like, it was like Southern punk rock. If that makes sense. It really was. It was like, it was in your face. It was, there was no apologizing for what it was, and the people ate it up. And that's what punk rock was. You know, when I would go see punk bands, you know, in my teen years, it was the same thing. It was in your face. I'm not apologizing, and people love it, you know, and if you don't love it, then get out. And that was kind of the attitude. But it wasn't something that was for everybody. That's for sure. But it kind of set the stage for other things that were going to come up. A lot of the same talents that rolled through Smokey eventually made their way up to the system for the, you know, eventual Monday Night Wars for the 90s.
Smokey was a breeding ground, completely a breeding ground. Yeah,
absolutely. You know, there would be, you know, Jericho got his first start, you know, in stateside, mm-hmm. really right there, you know, Lance Storm, the Gangsters, you know, Kane. There's guys, you know, guys who got their starts right there, really got a, and it was the last of a true territory in many ways. So there was loops that you were following every week. You know, that's something that, you know, modern day wrestling does not have, obviously. There's no concept of a territory system. But that really was one of the last of the true territories.
Now, you've been to underground stuff, and you've been to, you know, on these gritty tours with these bands and, you know, to clubs and things like that. But you've also been to huge shows.
Yes.
Rattle off some of your list of some of the huge shows you've been to, because you sent me a little bit of a list, and it's like, this is the who's who of some of the stuff of the 90s.
Yeah, I was at Woodstock 94, Woodstock 99. My favorite show was the Tibetan Freedom Festival concert in 95 in D.C. That show was unreal. It set the stage eventually for, you know, some of those bands going over and playing for Nelson Mandela in South Africa.
Who was on that show in 95?
So that was the Chili Peppers, U2, Live. There were several bands, but the show was kind of marred in the beginning. There was a bad storm on day one, and there was a lightning bolt that struck a fan in the crowd.
Oh, geez.
And actually canceled day one. The Chili Peppers were on stage getting ready to come on when that took place. So that was that show is sentimental to me for a couple reasons. One, it was a show that, you know, we were there for a message, for a reason, you know, trying to help the people of Tibet.
Yeah.
All the money was raised, you know, for Tibetan freedom. So I was totally behind that. It was a great cause. And two, now setting back after all these years here in 2019, when I met my wife, my current wife, my only wife, the wife that I'll be with the rest of my life, mm-hmm. my wife, I found out, you know, she grew up in D.C. and she actually was at that show.
Oh, that's awesome.
But we didn't know each other, obviously, at that time.
Well, there was so many people at that show, too.
Yeah. There was like, 150, you know, 175,000 people in RFK Stadium, you know. So it was not only just the whole stadium, but the whole floor of the stadium full, you know. So it was the equivalent of Live Aid. You know, you've seen all those pictures of Live Aid it was the same type of atmosphere, and a lot of the same producers who were involved with Live Aid were doing that show. So you've seen the crowd, like you've seen, you know, the performance with, you know, with Queen, with that huge crowd. That's what that crowd looked like. It was that type of crowd. Woodstock 94, I skipped town without my parents knowing that I was there, which was great. Woodstock 99, I was there with live working, hanging out backstage and hanging out with, and at that time I was doing a lot of the early social media for the band. And I told you a little side story about
before
that
we knew what social media was, by the way.
Yeah. Really. It really was. It was, it's what we were doing. We were trying to create like a, you know, a base. You know, we had postcards. We, you know, we would slide, you know, whatever it was, we were trying to do something to create like a mailing list, whatever it may be. We had, you know, early fan pages that we were using in 99 because the internet did exist, believe it or not, kids, but, we were trying to create something. And, but in 99, one of my cool stories from the 99 show was I was hanging out backstage, and Live's guitarist, Chad Taylor, his dad, who's a dear guy, David was hanging out, and he said, "Hey, we ran out of beer. Why don't you go across the other room over there and grab the rest of those beers?" So I went over, and as I was pulling the beers up, Scott Weiland looked at me and asked me what I was, why was I taking his booze? So, needless to say, that was an interesting moment, because as we know, Weiland, had his moments.
Yes,
he had some moments.
You probably should have taken it from him in retrospect, but yeah.
Yeah. Well, his choice was an alcohol to begin with, unfortunately it was heroin. But you know, those stories like that are things that, you know, kind of are mile markers in my life. Things that I can just look back on and say, you know, that was a lot of fun. That was a great time. And one of the things that makes me worried about my 21-year-old daughter now. So, those are all those stories are cherished memories, Ben, and something that I can never replace.
Who are some of the rock stars who are totally nice guys who you wouldn't assume are nice guys?
Oh, gosh. I can tell you a lot of the assholes.
The assholes too. That's gonna be my next question. That was my next question, and in reverse too. Yeah.
Like good guys that you would expect to be good guys. Dave Grohl was always like super. Just always giving, always nice. A guy that would just sit down and just talk to you about anything. Just very.
Was he a wrestling fan? Because that would make Dave Grohl our Lord and Savior, frankly.
You know, that I can't confirm. He did grow up in Northern Virginia, so he definitely was exposed to the old WWF for sure during that time period, and some Crockett too. I wouldn't be surprised if he didn't see it, but I can't pin him down and say, yeah, Dave's a wrestling fan. But Dave was always super nice and just a genuine dude. And like everything you see about him on TV, everything you see about all the clips of him, that's him.
Right.
He's a normal dude. He really is. Just a normal guy. Same thing with Pat Smear, who's a guitarist, who was also in Nirvana with the Foo Fighters. Great guy. Just genuine guy. One of my favorite guys in the whole world is Kevin Martin from Candlebox, lead singer of Candlebox. Kevin is probably he's salt of the earth, and his mother is actually someone who actually sends me Christmas cards every year.
Oh, that's adorable.
She's just a sweetheart, of a lady. Those are the kind of people like I built bonds with that were way beyond the music, and just got to be able to know their families and be around them, and they genuinely cared. They absolutely would take their shirt off their back to use the cliche. They're the kind of people that you definitely want to be around.
Bury one person.
Bury one person. Well, I would love to bury this one person, but I legally can't. So, Ben, that's a tough one. Let me see who I could definitely bury. If I had to pick one person, it actually would probably be Chris Robinson from the Black Crowes.
Really?
And I can tell you a story that will tell you just how big of an asshole he is. Now, he may have changed. Life may have gotten better. Mm-hmm. But I want to share a story, and it actually has something to do with wrestling.
Oh.
So let me give you the story. So Chris Robinson, who is the lead singer of the Black Crowes, who also, of course, has, you know, lived a high, high life in many, many ways.
It's very high. It's a very high life.
Way, way, way beyond just, you know, him being the lead singer of, you know, of the band and, you know, being a guitarist and being, you know, everything that you'd ever want as a lead singer. He also married Kate Hudson, if you remember correctly.
He did, yes.
Mm-hmm. So the guy has, you know, lived
and he botched that, by the way.
Yeah, he botched that completely. Mm-hmm. So, you know, so he's got that still going for him. But let's talk about a burial here. So with Chris, he was actually, of course, produced by Ruben, and Ruben hooked him up through Cornette and a couple other people through the Smokies with a local DJ in Tennessee who got them a private tour of Graceland. So they were going through Graceland, and at the time, walking through, and I've heard this story from several people, and I've met, and I knew Chris as well, and he was an asshole towards me, so I could definitely convey the message. So Chris is walking through Graceland, and they're downstairs at Graceland. If you've ever been to Graceland, you'll know this area. They're going through, and this huge, like, tunnel of just nothing but Elvis's, you know, gold, platinum, diamond status albums for everything. And they would go through, and he was pointing at him. He's like, I got one of those. I got one of those. I got one of those. And they get to the end, and there's this huge album, and it's basically like 100 million albums or whatever it is, like a status that, like, nobody has, you know, for all the collective albums that Elvis ever sold. And the tour guide looks at him. He goes, I guess you don't have one of those, do you, asshole? Because he got tired of listening to him the whole time bragging about what he's doing. So as they walk out, of course, like, the word gets back to Ruben. Ruben's embarrassed. Cornette's embarrassed. All these guys are embarrassed because they brought this guy in here as, like, this huge star. And, like, he's you know, basically just defaming and talking about how he's bigger than Elvis. And he's like, one album in. You know, it's ridiculous. You know, ridiculous. Ridiculous. So, yeah, burial complete. Chris Robinson, you were an asshole. I hope you're not an asshole anymore, but you definitely were an asshole then. You were an asshole to a lot of people.
Fascinating. Just well done. Well done. Actually, I have a couple friends who were like, worship the ground that Chris Robinson walks on, and I really hope they listen to this, because that just make it complete.
And if you don't want to hear from me, I've heard that story from multiple people who sourced that story. So it's not just from me. It's not hearsay. It's not some guy that's just on a podcast railing on a star from the 90s. It's absolute gospel by now, because it's been well sourced.
I might have you on another time to talk about the sports stuff, but you've had interesting sports life as well. Just connection with music and wrestling is absolutely fascinating. I think that as you mentioned, that it's basically two parallel universes. Do you miss the life in music? And you kind of step back from wrestling a little bit too. Which do you miss more, I guess?
I love wrestling. I'll always watch. I'm more into the historical stuff, the older stuff, as, you know, just because I'm getting older and that's what old guys do. Mm-hmm. But I do miss those days on the road in the music business. I was young and just out there living a lifestyle that you can only live for a certain amount of time. And that finite time for me was from about age 16 to about 23. And, you know, it was about a 6 or 7 year period where I just lived as fast as I possibly could live. I remember when I finally got off the road for the last time, I looked at some guys and said, I need to go home because I don't think I'm going to live. And I was being serious. I didn't think I was going to live at that point. I thought that I was burning it at both ends way too fast. And I was 23 years old, and I was going to be just some guy who burned out and didn't make it. And I was still going through, I was going to college, doing all those things. I graduated in between all this. I mean, I had a career. And I finally settled down, and I got married at 23, and I'm no longer with the same woman I was with at 23, but thank God I met her then, because I definitely would have could quite possibly be one of those casualties in that scene, but nowhere near as famous.
And the same thing happens in the wrestling industry too. These guys live too fast, too hard. You know, it's
absolutely
total parallel universe. It really is. Yeah, I mean, look at look at the Von Erichs thing we just watched. You know,
Look at the Gino thing. All that Dusty always said it was like living life at the end of a lightning bolt. And that's really what it is. It's you are living on the very, very edge of something that is very dangerous at all times. And that's the lifestyle. You're taking something to go to sleep. You're taking something to wake up. You're taking something to hit the stage. I saw guys who were completely out of their mind or just completely, you know, out of it, you know, on whatever drug that they were using. And they would go out on stage and put on a show and you'd never know. And go out for 2 or 3 hours. Like, you know, Scott Weiland, no longer here with us. I saw him shoot up on the side stage and then go right out there and perform like nothing was wrong. You know, that's unreal. That's unhuman. It doesn't make sense. And you hear stories about that from the wrestling business too, where guys would, you know, be doing stuff and, you know, they wouldn't sleep for 3 or 4 days, or they're hopped up on caffeine pills or trucker pills or whatever in between with some coke and, you know, making the next town, you know, and then taking something to come back down so they could sleep.
Who of those guys who's gone do you miss the most?
Oh gosh. Cornell.
Yeah. He's top of my list too. Yeah.
Chris was a poet. And I know that a lot of people will say like, oh, that's like an exaggeration. No, he was a real poet. He was a real artist. You know, he could take someone else's song and make it his own. Yeah. And that's something that that not everyone's able to do. And he did it with precise way that you almost thought it was his, you know? So, you know, for me, it's probably Cornell. The artist that influenced me the most, you know, my first concert as a child was Johnny Cash. I was 5 years old. That was my first show. My parents took me to see Johnny Cash and June Carter. You know, I was 5 years old, and that really shaped me in many ways. I've got to meet Cash a few times. Of course, there's the wrestling connection there with Ruben again. Cash was the guy that really set me, you know, into the music world, really, and set me into a way of stylistically away. So a lot of the bands and things I got into were influenced by his music too. So, you know, in summation, wrestling, music, all those things, there's a huge cross section. We got into sports tonight too.
Oh yeah.
There's a huge cross section there too. You know, so hopefully, you know, we can come back at some point and talk about.
We're gonna do a sports thing too. But
we'll do a sports thing too, because I got a chance to cover a lot of sports. I worked in, after I left the radio and television industry, I became a hardcore journalist working for the AP. You know, being a reporter.
And you covered LeBron James in high school, right?
I covered LeBron, and actually I grew up right on the Ohio River, so he wasn't far away. We could make a trip up to watch him play. But I saw two phenoms during that time period. One of those phenoms was LeBron, and the other was a kid named O.J. Mayo.
O.J. Mayo, who some argue was actually better than him in high school, actually.
Yes. I saw O.J. from the time he was a sixth grader. He grew up in Huntington, West Virginia, which is about 15 minutes from where I grew up. Yep. And he came across the river in Kentucky to play at a small Christian school, because as a middle schooler, he could play high school basketball. Yep. So he was starting on the varsity team as a seventh grader. So, you know, that tells you everything you need to know. And his story is a bit of a checkered story with the NBA too, with drugs.
He was a rock star.
Yeah. Yeah.
He was a rock star.
Absolutely. Yeah. He was a rock star from the time he was 13 years old. You know, he was living a lifestyle that no 13-year-old should be living. You know, so, but we'll get there later.
Yeah.
We'll get there eventually. But I appreciate you having me on.
Definitely.
And absolutely loved all the episodes you put out so far. and hope to keep hearing more from you.
Love you, brother. Do you have anything you want to plug going forward?
Yeah.
Anything like that? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You can follow me on Twitter. If you want to hear some takes on music and occasionally wrestling in life, you can find me at Pronounced JB. That's pronounced J-A-Y letter B. And I'm also in the process of working on my own podcast. Tentatively, it's named It Came from the 90s, and it's going to be some of my road stories shared with some of my brothers from out there that I had a chance to hang out with. So that's the we got a few things that are in the can with that. And actually, our good friend Dylan, he and I are also talking about possibly doing another podcast too. So amazing. about music. So lots of things that are out there for me to get involved with. Unfortunately, I've got to pay the bills, so I do have a real job, and I can't just sit around and play in my home studio. But I do appreciate your time, Ben, and I will be seeing you here in August.
I know. I can't wait, man. SCI is going to be amazing. I love you, brother. You're part of the family, and can't wait to see you in August, and I can't wait to hear your podcast, man.
All right. Appreciate it. Thanks.
Thanks, JB.
The Place to Be pop feed, Steve and Kelly celebrate 1 year of Songs with Friends live by watching some classic NSYNC. We get a heavy dose of hoops talk for you, courtesy of Cowboy and D'Amato in This Week in Sports, and Adam and Andrew on the NBA team. Andy Atherton and Mirandia Berthold are back at the movies for discussing Detective Pikachu. The Glenn Butler Podcast Hour Spectacular has returned, and Glenn and Scott are breaking down Star Trek Discovery Season 2. The Hard Traveling Fanboys are going off the page and talking about Marvel Ultimate Alliance. Also, stay tuned for the giant size edition of the show coming soon. It will include past guests and revealing the PTBN's composite rankings of all 22 MCU movies. Over at the Wrestling Feed, JT and Chad are back in the Wrestling War Zone. They discuss what was going on in WWF and WCW during the weeks of January 8th, 96. In the fourth episode of Row 1, Seat 1, I chatted with my buddies Tommy and Gator. Gator talked about his recent experience promoting an independent show in the DC area. Scott and JT welcomed in Jambalaya Jake Williams to break down the April 89 MSG House Show, featuring a big WrestleMania main event rematch. And finally, Scott Criscolo, Mate Milton, and Steve Willey break down, have previews of Money in the Bank and Double or Nothing, the newest edition of Main Event. Check out our social media pages and message board at biglow34.proboards.com for information on joining our GWWE pay-per-view and TV match ever project. Get in the conversation and start researching your list.
All right, I am here with Josh Allen and Jesse Butler. They are veterans of the hardcore scene and huge wrestling fans, and I couldn't help but have them on. They're both absolute brothers of mine as well. And we're going to talk a little bit about the marriage of hardcore and wrestling a little bit. Josh, tell me a little about what you're doing now and where wrestling and hardcore kind of meet for you, because you're doing a very interesting thing right now with wrestling and hardcore.
Right now I'm in a band called Heel Turn. It's actually a 80s pro wrestling themed hardcore band.
Which is the best shit ever, by the way.
Yeah, I guess it really like stemmed from like all throughout high school. I just like, I loved punk rock and I loved pro wrestling, and I always thought it'd be a really cool idea to do that, to have a band like that. And to begin with, I wanted it to be more of like a, it really was going to be like a comedy thing, kind of. Not really a comedy thing, I guess, but just like a party band, you know, like just play shows here and there and just do like weird punk shit. But then every time I do anything, I just take it way too seriously because I'm a fucking nerd. So like kind of took off from there and like tore a good bit and things like that. Most of our stuff's like about like 80s territory era professional wrestling.
You just got back from tour, right?
Yeah, I got back at 4 a.m. Monday morning and then went to work at 4:45.
Seems dumb. Seems bad.
Yeah, it was really dumb. That's what I do every time, though. So, because now, like, with two kids, I can't really, like, back in the day, I used to, like, tour, you know, a month or two at a time. But with children, I have to be, like, responsible. So I have to, like, go on, like, 3 to 7 day runs. So, like, I can't afford to, like, take off much more work. So usually I just get home, like, super late, like, an hour before I have to go to work and end up just going to work the next morning. And it's fucking miserable, but.
And then, Jesse, you were in a bunch of hardcore bands, and basically the promotion you run now, you basically, you're the ring announcer, and everyone joked that you basically ring announce like you're telling people to get in the fucking pit.
Yeah, so basically throughout my teens and, like, early 20s, I had a poor attempt at singing in hardcore bands. I actually told this story not too long ago. Somebody finally asked me, like, why I was ring announcing. And it's because we couldn't afford to pay anybody else from the first show. So that's how I pretty much got the gig ring announcing. I was like, well, fuck it, I'll do it. And then I just remember standing in the Cobra where we did the first sub show. And I just realized that I was standing in the middle of a room with a microphone. And I was like, what if I just do this like a hardcore show? People are either going to laugh or they're going to love it. And it just kind of stuck. I took a couple shows off. We tried out some different people. One of them being Steve McCash, who got moved to commentary and is doing a stellar job. And because it makes Koo laugh, I'm back. Koo like laughs and he loves it at the same time, just because it adds to the environment. But yeah, that's kind of the origin story of that. I just yell shit at people and yeah.
No, I loved it. We were at WrestleMania weekend, and I was just standing among random people from Cleveland, and you started ring announcing for the Southern Underground Pro Show at Family Reunion, and the random guys from Cleveland behind me just started screaming out, "Get in the fucking pit!" And I'm like, that Southern Underground Pro, I was beaming with pride at that exact very moment, and that was everything that I fucking loved. And that kind of brings us to, like, what I love about Southern Underground Pro, and Josh, what I love about your band is it kind of marries wrestling and hardcore, and hardcore is a genre of music that I grew up with in Boston as well. You guys are much more steeped in it than I am, because I was just some fucking geek who carried people's equipment and started mosh pits. But you guys were in the shit, and you guys were actually in bands and stuff like that. Josh, you were in the Northern Alabama scene, and Jesse, you were in Nashville. But wrestling has all. We were talking a little bit earlier. You guys, wrestling was kind of always in the background, was it not?
Oh yeah, for sure.
Throughout high school, like, I didn't go to either one of my proms because I was either the first one backyard wrestling or the second one at some fucking show. It was usually either or at any time.
Yeah, that same applies to me. My parents were both really into wrestling, so I, for as long as I can remember, was always into pro wrestling. So even as, like, I started getting into punk rock and hardcore, like, wrestling never really left my mindset, you know.
Describe the scene of a hardcore show. So some of the people who may be listening, like, aren't really familiar with hardcore music. Describe the scene of a hardcore show, maybe even, you know, necessarily in pro wrestling terminology. What, you know, what, because I think some of the language is a little bit the same, actually.
Josh, do you do you want to give one, and then I'll give one?
Yeah, that sounds good. I mean, honestly, like, It's weird to me as I've gotten older and started going to a lot more indie shows, how much DIY ties together throughout hardcore and ties together through, like, independent wrestling. I mean, like, Southern Underground Pro is a perfect example of that. I mean, all standing room, Jesse's doing his shit on the mic, you know, like, we actually played a death match in New Orleans. It was the first death match in New Orleans since Cactus Jack and Vader at Halloween Havoc. And it was like Casanova Valentine and Marcus Crane. And
Jesus.
It's just fucking crazy. Like, the same people you see at a hardcore show are usually the same people, the type of people that I see at independent shows. I mean, like, the aesthetic is all the same. I mean, like, in a way, like with DIY, like people are looking out for themselves in a way, just like, you know, a lot of indie wrestlers are and things like that. But I feel like it's a huge community as well. I know that just from like Twitter and everything else, as far as like wrestling goes, there's a huge collective of friends I've made just by going to, you know, SEI, Southern Underground Pro, shows like that. And it's the same way here. I mean, I believe, Jesse, didn't you and I meet each other through hardcore?
I want to say I either booked you guys or I was at the show that you guys got booked on. And I want to say it was one of those weird garage shows we had for a while.
It was, yeah, it was, I think we met in at a show in Alabama or something like that. And then you booked us or got us on a show with that band Advent at that, like, what was it, that Garage 305 or something like that in Nashville? Yeah, because I just remember that venue being the loudest fucking venue, like, of all time. Just because of how much it, like, echoed and resonated. It was just, every band sounded insane that played there.
Yeah, that venue was absolutely nuts. And quick little sidebar about that. If anybody listening to this knows the band Advent, then you'll appreciate the story. But Josh, I saw Joe from Advent like a month after that when he was playing drums for the Almost.
Oh, and, yeah.
I introduced myself to him and we were talking and he was like, oh, yeah, that garage venue was so sick. And I was like, yeah, we just lost it. And he told me it was like his favorite venue they played on tour. And I just had to break his heart and tell him we lost
Dude,
it like
sucks.
Days before I saw him.
That sucks. Like it was, I think it was like, it was probably like 4 or 5 months after we played that. He let us crash at his house in North Carolina. And he was like the first person that ever took me to Cookout. He like introduced me to Cookout, which was like incredible.
Speaking Jesse's language now.
Hell yeah. If I had to describe hardcore shows to anybody listening that doesn't know hardcore, I would say take the most aggressive music that you listen to and probably amplify at times. It literally is like the old wrestling terminology, like take it and turn it up to 11. You're just in a room, usually a very small, dimly lit room, with a bunch of fucking maniacs that are just swinging at each other, and it's just aggressive music. And you know, 9 times out of 10, nobody means any harm to anybody, but accidents happen. And it's just like, the reason I fell in love with hardcore shows was, you know, for the longest time I had this fear in my gut of like, am I gonna get the shit kicked out of me? Like, what's gonna happen? You never knew what was gonna happen. It was always just such a kind of volatile and just unpredictable environment. But yeah, I know. Josh touched on something, the DIY mentality, you know, that bands have is very similar to what independent wrestlers have, you know, where usually they're designing their own merch or their friends are designing their own merch, or you know, their, you know, friends are designing merch for you. Everybody's usually trying to help each other out. You know, you hop in a car, you get as many people in a car as you can to, you know, save on gas and make it cheaper. You're crashing at people's houses, you know, friends, fans, whatever. Before he started wrestling, Kerry Offal had like the best, you know, just kind of association where he said that wrestling is probably a lot like hardcore, where you just jump in a car with friends and go and make it happen. And I think that's probably one of the truest things I've ever heard about independent wrestling.
So is that what drew you guys to hardcore? Because like, you know, people get drawn in different music for different reasons. You know, Josh, you talked about the sense of community. Jesse, you kind of talked about, you know, that, you know, the release of aggression, things like that. Are those the main things that drew you guys to hardcore in the beginning? You know, for people who aren't familiar with hardcore, like if someone's just like, I should try this out, like what type of person would be drawn to hardcore?
Well, I feel for me that like Jesse said, the aggressive nature of it, but it also was like, I grew up a fucking weird kid, you know what I mean? I guess that's true. Yeah, true. So, but I always felt really out of place all throughout like high school and things like that. And I had a very small, you know, collection of friends. And one guy was, a few years older than I was. And he's the one that introduced me to like punk music. And through there, I started like finding my own things. But like hardcore, like even though it's aggressive, it's also like extremely nerdy. Like just being in love with music, I'm sure anybody can relate to this, is like a really like nerdy aspect in my opinion. And that I kind of like just found like hope in that. I found other like weird people that were like me, and like that's really like what pulled me in and like kept me there. Was people were just introducing me to new cool things that I liked, but they were just as weird as I was. Like we all just felt like outcast, you know what I mean? So I think that's what drew me in and like kept me there originally.
Yeah, my first few shows, I was like, I guess just for lack of a better, you know, wording, just nervous because the only people I knew were the few people that I went with. And there's just a room full of people that, you know, just to have all this aggression from, you know, from whatever, and they're just letting it out in like what's typically supposed to be a positive way. But you don't really know that your first few times going. So yeah. You're just like, it's a weird adrenaline rush, and I'm kind of naturally drawn to those things. But then the longer you stick around and the more you come around and you show your face and people realize that like this is something you care about, then there's that sense of community. And honestly, I do think that is what kept me around for so long, was because there were people who, you know, I can't tell you how many shows I booked where I didn't get a single thing in return, aside from seeing a band that I wanted to see or, you know, helping somebody out. And there were a bunch of people in Nashville like that where you might actually lose money booking a show, but, you know, there was like 20, 30 people in there, if that, that had, you know, the best, you know, maybe that was like what was keeping them holding on, you know, for whatever reason. So just that sense of community, and then, you know, how creativity is pushed within hardcore. And then, like Josh said, it's just full of fucking nerdy weirdos. And I think we can all relate to that being wrestling fans.
Yeah, I was going to say, this sounds a lot like wrestling. Nerdy fucking weirdos who find their people, basically. Like, this is... And I grew up with it, too. And it's kind of... This sounds a lot like my experience growing up with hardcore as well, is that, like, I found... We called it the scene. And I don't know if you guys use the same terminology, but I found a scene.
Yeah, sure.
And I found a group of people who thought like me and thought... and walk like me and talk like me, and like, you know, who, and I didn't have that at my school because I went to freaking prep school, you know, so like I certainly didn't have that at my prep school, you know, so like I found people who were into cool music and were social outcasts like I was, and, you know, were just fucking weirdos like I was, and just, you know, every fucking weekend we were just sharing a thing with cool music that we liked, and it was awesome. It was absolutely awesome. And I mean, that was every weekend in high school and most weekends in college. It was the blast.
Yeah. And I think to Jesse's point too, like just talking about like, just like the sense of like someone possibly needing it. And, you know, you might be losing money on a show you booked. I used to book shows like in this barn in the woods in the middle of like nowhere, Alabama. And, you know, we'd bring touring acts in, you know, national acts and stuff like that. And like, there's plenty of times I paid completely like out of my pocket, but there was times where like I was the one that needed that, you know what I mean? So like I still hold all those times like really like close to me for like the same reason that Jesse just said.
Josh, you're doing it again, you know, now that you're a little older. Do you get the same sense of validation now that you're older, and the same emotional response, or is it scratching a different itch for you now?
I think there's still parts to it. When I was doing it before, you know, when I was first doing it, I was really young when we were touring. I was, you know, from 18 to 21 years old. It's like when we were like touring around the country, and our drummer, Jake Warren, he died in a car wreck, and that's what it actually ended up keeping me from music. We decided I didn't feel like it was right to continue the band without him. And like,
and which band was this?
It was called Dead Heroes. And, like that sense of like community was still there, because there was definitely still friends that reached out, and like, everyone, I think Jesse even drove down from Nashville for his like memorial show that we had for him. But when he died, like I didn't want to do that band anymore, and I couldn't go to shows anymore, just because like I guess it was just too real for me, and
understandable.
That took a couple years for me to like even like give a shit about music anymore. Like, it just related to him so much. So, like, you know, years passed, and then I was interested in starting to play music again. I don't know. It was weird, though, because, you know, next month I'll be 30, and I started doing Hill Turn a year and a half ago. And so, like, you know, back in the day, like, all we did was just, like, party and go play shows, like, no responsibilities. It didn't really matter, you know, didn't really worry about fucking anything. But now, like, when I first came back, I felt really out of place again, just like how Jesse was talking about, like, when you first start going to shows, you kind of feel out of place. I definitely felt that way. I felt like I was too old, that everybody just saw me as, like, the old weird dude there. But it didn't take long, though, for me to, like, remember, like, why I love this. And it kind of, you know, the past is the past, and things happen, and that there was a reason why I wasn't playing music anymore, you know, after my friend passed. But part of me still looks back, like, on why did I stop doing this? Like, just because that feeling is, like, so strong, you know, and I thought that was, like, lost on me for forever at one point. But now, like, there, you know, I still get the same feelings I did at points, but there's also a lot more, as far as, like, playing music, a lot more, like, anxiety and frustration with it, because now I'm like, oh, hey, I'm doing this on the side, but, like, I still have, like, responsibilities and things like that with, like, children and whatnot. So I'm, like, trying to do this, like, balancing act. So it's a very weird feeling, I guess.
And Jesse, you're not involved in music anymore, but you went and decided to start your own wrestling promotion. So wrestling went from this fun thing that you liked to this thing that you took a gamble on.
Yeah, man. So basically, you know, I've known Kevin Koo for, oh man, at least a decade at this point. And we were always kind of just like acquaintances. And then I was going down to Atlanta quite a bit for these wrestling shows, found out that he lived in Atlanta. And then we just kind of met up, and we did an interview for my old podcast. And then from there, we just stayed in contact. And I had told him that I kind of wanted to try to run a spot show outside of a bar here in Nashville just to see what would happen. Something like real low budget, just, you know, really just to get my feet wet. If it flopped, whatever. If it did cool, you know, if it did great, then cool. Everybody get paid. Everybody make a little bit of money. So then, in a weird turn of events, he ends up getting a job offer here in Nashville, and he hits me up and he was like, yo, you know, I'm moving to Nashville. I want to do this. I want to start this promotion. So I was like, yeah, if you need any help, just hit me up. And he was like, well, that's why I'm telling you, because I want you to help. So it's been a little over 2 years now. We started it inside of a bar called the Cobra in their event space. After hanging out with Koo on Saturday, I was under the impression that we fit 80 people plus talent in the tiny ass room we were in. Apparently it was more like 120 plus talent.
Yeah,
as I was gonna say, it felt like a breathe. Lot more than 80.
Yeah, I couldn't breathe, like, there, so it was definitely more than 80.
Yeah, I had no clue that it was that much more. But yeah, we kind of, you know, it started off as like a Simpson then a Hayfried joke. Like, if you ever just get stupid bored and want to just go lurk the sup Twitter, like, I'm pretty sure the first few tweets are all just Hayfried lyrics. And then our title is obviously a Simpsons reference. But when we started doing it, it was very, like, touch and go, like, show by show. Like, maybe we'll do another one, maybe we won't. But then we just noticed that, much like hardcore, we were building a community. And it became, for me, it became less about, you know, like, the show, and more of the community, the people that I saw every show, the people who, you know, I pretty much see what they're going through every day on the internet. And if it's, you know, something serious or heavy, I try to reach out and let them know, you know, hey, I'm here if you need anything.
Yeah, but, it's the most family, honestly, the most family atmosphere of any show I've ever been to.
And that's what I love, man. It literally feels like a hardcore show. Like, even with people that have never been to a hardcore show, it's the exact same feeling, except I feel like most of us are older and we're not punching each other. We're jumping off. Most of us aren't jumping off of stuff. But I recently just earlier this year, like, let go of all booking decisions that I had just due to like stress, and it was just causing me to not enjoy wrestling as much, which is something that I didn't want to do, because without wrestling, then all I would have was this giant collection of VHS tapes that I'd eventually have to watch. So now I just have this giant collection of VHS tapes that kind of gets neglected.
But you're still on the Mount Rushmore of SUP. That's why I want to have you on.
Well, I appreciate that. Uh-huh. And, you know, it's cool because people associate me with SUP, and I wouldn't have it any other way. You know, I can't tell you how many times I get stopped at a show. And even if it seems like I'm, like, flustered or frustrated, I'm not. I just, you know, show days are always super crazy. But it, you know, SUP is home, and it's, you know, it's my new hardcore show, basically, in Nashville. It's like I get all the perks of being in a band without having to have band practice, which was my least favorite part about being in a band.
Josh, you've been to SUP shows with me. I describe it basically as the most family atmosphere ever. What I love about SUP shows especially is that it's this mix of internet geeks and Nashville hipsters, but everyone loves each other. Would you necessarily agree with that, or would you have something better to add to that than me?
I mean, because, you know, like, I went to the very first show as well. I mean, I think that not, like, it was in the Cobra, you know, like, just, it was in the Cobra. It was so small, and just, like, the atmosphere, I think that really set the tone, at least for me as, like, a fan, and I feel like that's the way everyone else feels. It really set the tone for, like, the way the environment is there, you know, like I said earlier, like standing room only, things like that. But it's honestly, like, there's not a better crowd than the SUP crowd, in my opinion. I've never seen a place that, like, if you're a good guy, they're going to fucking cheer the shit out of you. And if you're a bad guy, they're going to boo the fuck out of you. I mean, people were throwing trash at MJF, like, back in August. I mean, you know. Good. Exactly. But, you know, like you said, like, it's a weird collection of people, but all of this comes back to community. I mean, that's what this is, you know. And, like, I don't know. The environment itself is unlike any other independent show that I've ever been to. Like, it's the closest thing I can relate to a hardcore or a punk show. But also, like, there's a lot of community there that there sometimes isn't at punk shows, and sometimes even in wrestling, because, you know, like, it's still, you know, you guys are, you know, Jesse's a lot more involved in wrestling than I am, but wrestling is still a business, so there's still a lot of times where it's like people are, like, looking out for themselves. But that's not the feeling I get when I see anything that happens to SUP, even the wrestlers, like, even on Twitter, like, everyone seems to be like a huge family that's looking out for one another.
Yeah.
And that's one thing I want to, you know, credit is everybody that's involved with the show. You know, whether they're on, you know, every single show, or like they're semi-regulars, or we can only grab them every now and then. Especially on the internet, everybody's like a super team player, and they usually have no problem resharing stuff, you know, without being asked, you know. It seems like everybody that's come through, for the most part, has really enjoyed their time. And that's something that I, you know, I value a lot, because nobody wants to, you know, make a, you know, a drive, you know, for X amount of hours, and go somewhere they don't want to be and do a show they don't want to do. You know, everybody wants to have fun. And if we can make this fun for literally everybody, then I think mission accomplished.
Yeah. Such a great atmosphere. It really, really is. And conversely, talk about heel turn shows, because I think heel turn shows are fascinating atmosphere too.
I mean, at home we have a pretty good sense of, like, random people that come, like, because in Huntsville we don't really have that much of a hardcore scene. We have somewhat of a hardcore scene, but the hardcore scene that's here, like, we don't really, like, fit that aesthetic, I guess. Because we're not cool, because we're a wrestling band.
Yeah, do you what type of people do you get at the shows? Do you get wrestling fans? Do you get hardcore fans? Do you get, like, I mean, is it people who are expect, like, what sort of expectations do people have when they hear a wrestling themed hardcore band, I guess?
It is hardly ever in the middle. It's either people are losing their shit because they also love hardcore and pro wrestling.
Guilty.
We also have, like, because we make a lot of, like, rip-off, like, wrestling t-shirts that we sell online. And there's been so many times people have, like, bought our shirts on Twitter and then, like, quote tweet it and be like, I've never heard this band and I will never listen to this band, but this is a cool shirt. And I'm like, hell yeah, that's cool, me. So, but there's that. But then there's also, on the opposite end of the spectrum, like, we played a show last month in Roanoke, Virginia. And this dude came up to me afterwards and he was like, hey man, your set sounded really good. I just listened to it from outside. He's like, I didn't come in because he's like, you guys really surprised me and shocked me, you know, because I really expected, you know, being a wrestling band, like, y'all were just going to be like rolling around on the fucking ground, like hitting each other and just stupid bullshit, you know. And I was like, okay, well, yeah, it's not that. It's just like, because I like try to use wrestling as a form of, like, storytelling. I mean, because that's what wrestling is. I mean, wrestling can be, you know, evolved into anything, you know. And so I try to use that as, like, forms of storytelling into the lyrics. It's definitely not me trying to put on a wrestling mask and, like, hit somebody with a chair. That's, but people fully expect that sometimes. he actually told me. The same guy told me that, listen, man, I think the band is good, but you've just got to give up that bullshit. He's like, nobody will ever take you seriously. And I was like, you saying that just made, like, me want to write 10 more wrestling records for, like, no other reason than that you hate it so much, you know? But a lot of the time, most of the time, like, there's a couple people that are in the middle, but for the most part, just normal people. If anything, I think a lot of people just like the nostalgia of it. Even if they're not into wrestling anymore, they grew up watching, you know, like during the Monday Night Wars and things like that. So, like, it's at least like a callback for people. So I think people, like, at least get behind it in that aspect.
Have you guys been met with a crowd that absolutely just shit on it? Because you guys have been touring all over the fucking place.
No, not really. I mean, everybody's been pretty receptive. I mean, like, because we're not, you know, and I think a lot of that's because we're not over the top about it. Like, I don't wear one, like, two of the guys in the band, like, wear a wrestling mask while we play. And other than the songs being about wrestling, and if you saw our merch table, you probably wouldn't know that we were a wrestling-themed band. You know what I mean? So I think, like, people are pretty receptive because some people probably don't even realize, like, maybe what we're doing exactly.
Speaking of your merch, by the way, you have the best merch, like, on the planet. Like, your rip-off t-shirts, you mock them, but, like, your t-shirts are amazing. I wore one today, that Steiner Brothers shirt. Like, your t-shirts, friggin' Homicide came up to me and wanted one in Jersey. Like, your t-shirts are dope as shit. Yeah.
Well, that's awesome.
Just kind of closing up here a little bit here. So, Josh, what are the plans ahead for Heel Turn?
We just released a 7-inch with this band from New Orleans called Ecumen. On the Ghost is Clear Records that came out like a week ago.
It's awesome.
We just got back from a short weekend of run. In June, we are touring up to, we're doing Louisville, Kentucky, Cincinnati, Ohio, Chicago, Illinois, St. Louis, Missouri, and then back down to Nashville. And then July, we'll be going through like New Orleans, Mississippi, Florida, and August we'll be doing Texas. So a whole lot of show playing, really.
Are you guys playing with Thieves in Chicago?
They are in talks right now. We're playing with this other band called Frail Body that are really good friends with them. Okay. And we've been in talks. Like, that show is still, like, they still need one more local, and they're basically waiting on Thieves to see if they can play or not, actually.
They fucking better. I love those guys.
Dude, like, that band is so good. Like, it blows my mind how good that band is.
That band was the last hardcore show that I went to. Brittany and I went and saw them in a basement. And I warned her. I was like, this band is really fucking loud. And they're really aggressive. I once saw them play with Cove in a living room. And they played... Thieves would play a song. And then Cove would play a song.
That's so rad.
And they had... Yeah. All their gear pointed at each other, so it was literally Jesus just like Christ. A fucking. Yes. It just constantly just a sounded wall like a car of sound. In there.
Oh that's. We actually have some friends from New Orleans in this band called Crossed, and we were wanting to do that exact thing, like just put everyone in the middle of both of us, and just play, you know, song after song against one another.
Because like, I feel like everybody has to experience that once because holy insane. Shit, I couldn't hear right for a week.
Like, do you remember that band Legion? From Birmingham. Yeah. Okay, so the first time I ever played Birmingham, Legion played, and it was at Cave 9, and when they got ready to play, they played on the floor instead of the stage, and they made everyone, they basically lined up against the amps like roughly 6 feet from the wall, and made everyone stand against the wall while they played through like two full stacks and like two 8x10s.
Jesus.
And it literally felt like I was being murdered. Like, I just remember like that experience was just like I want to be like, from then on, I'm like, dude, I have to be in a heavy band from now on. Like, there's just like, no, it's inevitable now.
Hardcore. It's like you're being murdered. You guys are selling it wonderfully.
I mean, he's not wrong.
Josh's band is not like being murdered. He has his shows are wonderful. Please go see them.
Jesse, there's actually a really cool band we played with in Nashville a couple of months ago. They're called Offhand. We're actually doing our July tour with them. If you could ever check them out, they're a really rad band. They sound like kind of like almost like Power Violence with like weird vocal effects. They're young dudes, but like for their age, like they just like blow me away how good they are.
Oh yeah.
So Josh, you're going to be all over the country. Jesse, what do you have planned coming up? I know there's a show on the 2nd of June.
Yeah, we've got a sup show at Basement East on June 2nd.
And then you're doing announcing at New South, right?
Yeah, so I do ring announcing for Sup. I do commentary at New South. I've got some dates lined up there. I do commentary at Bizarro Lucha, which is like that's in Indianapolis. And that's like so Sup would be a hardcore show. I feel like Bizarro would be like a street punk or like a like the more punk version of Sup. Rather than like the hardcore version of Sup.
Yeah.
And then I'll be ring announcing for GCW in Nashville on July 21st.
Oh, we're going to have a lot of shows about that. Trust me. Trust me, brother. I am so geeked for that show. Are you doing the Wombat show too?
I'm not. I have the night off. So I'm just going to sit back and enjoy that spectacle because that is going to be.
I'm bringing my child, brother.
Oh, my God.
Making choices.
Yeah, you are. Brett
told me it was a good idea.
Who did?
Brett.
Lauderdale?
Brett Lauderdale said it is child safe.
Incredible.
Yeah. So I'm bringing my child to the Wombat Wrestling Show.
Man, Tullahoma, Tennessee. That's going to be so much fun.
It's going to be amazing. Going to be amazing.
Trying to think if there's anything else. I just, you know, I'll be in, I can't remember. I think it's Normal, Illinois. Doing Iron Spirit Pro. I'm not entirely sure what I'll be doing there. It's metal fucking name. Yeah, right? That's part of the reason I was like, yep, let's fucking go. So I'll be doing something there. I'm not entirely sure. There's one of two roles that's been talked about. Either way, it's going to be a lot of fun. Then I've got Bizarro the next day. But yeah, I'm just all over the place.
Awesome.
Doing commentary and ring announcing and just fucking living. I got a funny story about one of Josh's tours coming through Nashville, though, from like years ago.
Oh my God.
So my now tattoo artist used to have this house in East Nashville, and Josh's band and another band. I think Gibbs's band played Downsided.
Yeah, yeah. His other band played. It was basically Dead Heroes with a different singer.
Yeah. So they played. Then we went back to our friend Alice's house, and I think I saw Heath break Edge that night, funneling a 40 through a dirty garden hose down a flight of stairs into a basement.
As one does.
And for some reason, that's just like burned into my brain, and I love it so much.
Yes. That night also, our friend, I think, I'm trying to remember who had the moonshine. I don't remember who had the moonshine, but it might have been Alice that it was hers. I can't remember. But our friend Jake, like, had, he took, like, God, it was, like, honestly, like, 20 shots of this moonshine.
Oh, God.
And at the time period, that whole tour gives this thing was he would jokingly, in front of strangers, come up behind me and put a knife to my neck.
I remember that now.
Like, for some reason. And I it's burned into my brain because it would terrify me every time. I'm like, dude, you're going to accidentally slit my throat somehow. But they were like, Josh, take a shot of this, you know, moonshine. So I take a shot. I'm like, dude, that's fucking terrible. I don't want another shot of that. So, of course, he pulls out the knife. And there's actually pictures. I think Sasha Park has them. Well, there's, like, a picture of somebody putting a shot glass in my face. Then me being like, no, the next one. Gibbs has a knife in my face, and the next one I'm taking a shot. So Jake ends up taking like 20 shots of this whiskey. And apparently, were you at the party they had before that, that Jake and Heath were there?
Jesse? I think so.
Apparently there was this guy there named Tank.
And not the Tank we know.
No.
God, I wish. Different
Tank. That'd be amazing.
But this guy apparently was at this party, and he's like, going crazy, and everyone's like chanting his name as he's chugging beers and shit. So the next day, and like Jake was just in love with this dude, like just thought he was the greatest human of all time. So the next morning, he's like, dude, he asked Alice and them, he was like, where's Tank? And they're like, what do you mean? Like, because they stayed the night, they're like, what do you mean? Like, he came with you guys. They're like, no, like, he's y'all's friend. Like, no one knew who this dude was who ended up being at this party, just like, you know, just like throwing down and acting crazy. So
just wedding crashed the party.
Yeah. So that night, Jake has like 20 shots, and he ends up getting naked, and is just like kind of like talking to everyone, and he's like yellow because he's so drunk. And I remember he went to like take a shit or something, and he had to vomit, and he passed out in his own shit, and
I remember
vomit.
That.
And we had to give him a bath. So the next morning, and also Jake was known for never wearing underwear. So like the next morning, we put him in a sleeping bag, everything else like that. Next morning, this dude wakes up still drunk, starts chugging beers again. But he wakes up and he has underwear on. And he's covered in piss. And when we laid him down, he was still naked. He wakes up the next morning and he's like, dude, oh, man, I smell like piss, and why do I have underwear on? He's like, did I get laid last night? Like, dude, you were the furthest that anyone has ever been from getting laid. Like,
I think God. We're going to end the podcast on that story.
Yeah, I think there's nowhere else to go.
There's nowhere else to go from there. Gentlemen, y'all are family. Love you both. That's the perfect way to end it right there. That's the music episode, folks. Hardcore is awesome. Wrestling's awesome. You should listen to one and attend the other. We're going to be back next week on Row 1, Seat 1, and we're not going to have stories about naked shit, piss, and vomit, I assure you. Thank you guys for tuning in. I know, right?
Shit. Well,
okay. You know, there's always possibility, but I somehow doubt it. So thank you guys for tuning in. Thank you.